It's 1 p.m. already, and let me start our class. It's the lecture number 6 for the material testing. And I'd like to start on what I will be decide our midterm examination. Actually, the midterm is going to be multiple choices exam. But I didn't have that example. I may give you the guideline for the question for our examination like this. I will ask you the question, and then the answer for the question will be given into 5 multiple choices, A, B, C, D, and E. And at the end of the examination, we will have 1 brief written examination, and I will show you guys about that later. What are the questions for the midterm examination? For example, I may ask you the main objective of these courses. Actually, there are 2 main objectives. 1, to obtain the behavior, mechanical property, and the mode of failure of the material. And then you will use the obtained data in the analysis and design of the structure. That means you may test the material basis on the Thailand industrial standard or other standards such as ASTM, Japanese Industrial Standard, the British Standard, by testing the material according to those standards, you will understand the behavior of the material, mechanical properties of the material, and mode of failure of the material. And then you use those in the analysis and design of the structure, okay? And then for the second problem, if, for example, if we test a number of specimen, for example, if you do the tension test for the steel for 100 specimen, what kind of statistic distribution should we have for the obtained data? The most basic distribution is going to be the normal distribution. And when we're talking about this, we also need to determine the mean of the data, the standard deviation, and the coefficient of variation. This important value also requires to analysis the obtained data, okay? And basis upon this, if you may recall, the shape of the normal distribution is like a bell shape, and the total area of under this curve is going to be 1.0, and at this point it represents the mean of the data. And then if the data have large distribution, you may have a flat, okay, normal curve. If the data distribute very good shape, the shape of the normal distribution will be something like this. Talking about the mean, what the mean is, if you use the mean in your consideration, half of the specimen will pass this value, and another half of the specimen cannot pass it. Based upon this, we call this is going to be the reliability, okay? And then when you reduce the data that's checking for the pass or fail. For example, if you use X bar minus CSD, the value of this will be reduced and the number of specimen will pass this value more. That means you have higher reliability. Okay, and then the portion of this is going to call the probability to failure. Okay, and then if you say this is P and this is R, you will have P plus R equal to 1. And then you may use this equation to calculate the probability to failure or calculate the reliability. So problem number C, if the mechanical properties of material has reliability of 0.5, what is the value and the fraction of the probability to failure? So based upon this, again, you said you have half 0.5 reliability. So this is going to represent 0.5 reliability. So the probability to failure P is going to be 1 minus R. And then you got the probability to failure to be 0.5. That's going to be 1 out of 2, going to be under the value, the mean value of the obtained results. And then the problem may ask you, why do we use this equation or this equation to find the mechanical property of the materials instead of the sample mean in the quality control testing? Let me tell you first, the mu is going to be theoretical mean. Okay, it's calculated from very large number of data, but in reality, the number of data or specimen we have is going to be limited. So we will have the X bar to represent the sample mean. Okay, that's the number of specimen can be limited to 20 or 10 or even 5. And SD is the standard deviation of the sample. But this sigma is going to be theoretical standard deviation. And then when we talking about this, like I told you, if the mean is at 100 and then the SD is going to be 20 and you use the X bar minus maybe 1 standard deviation, if this one is 20, you use it for 80. If you use the 80, the number of specimen that's passing this 80 is going to be increased. So this means you're going to increase the reliability of your material, or you increase the safety to the material because you use smaller number of the testing result. Or in another aspect, this means you decrease the probability to failure. The area under this is smaller. It represents this. The area on the right-hand side is larger. It represents the increase in the reliability of the data. And then I may ask you to use your calculator to determine, for example, the sample mean. This is going to be the X bar, the sample standard deviation for this given value. Okay, so be practice to use your calculator. I only allow you to use the calculator. It can be any kind of calculator, but no computer program, no Microsoft Excel. Okay, and the other type of question I may ask you about the definition of some important mechanical property. Okay, and what is the mechanical property of this material? For example, if we talking about the strength, the definition of strength is the ability of the material to resist apply force without failure. And we use this yielding stress for the steel to represent the strength. And in the design, the sigma allowable will be sigma sub y divided by a proper factor of safety. So this one we call the strength of the steel. But the steel usually used in tension and also in compression, but the concrete, most of the time the concrete such as one in the column is subjected to the compression. So we will use the ultimate compressive stress for the concrete to represent the strength of the concrete, and the value can be typically 20 to 80 megapascal. And the value for the yielding strength of the steel can be 250 megapascal or 2,400 kilogram per square centimeter. Okay, and then if I give you a stress strain diagram, as the one like this, you supposed to be able to determine the sigma sub y. There is another type of stress strain diagram in which the curve is like this. By having no clear yielding point, the material like this, you must use 0.2% offset to determine the yielding stress. So for the yielding stress, I may ask you many ways, okay? And then the stiffness. What the definition of the stiffness? The stiffness is the ability of the material to resist deformation under applied force. And then we use the slope in the linear elastic region to represent it. And we determine it from the Hooke's law, sigma equal to E times strain. And then the modulus of elasticity is going to be delta sigma divided by the delta epsilon. And for the steel, the modulus of elasticity of the steel is 200 gigapascal or 200,000 kilogram per square centimeter. However, if we talking about the concrete, E of the concrete will change with its strength. So as we know, the strength of the concrete can be 20 to 80. The E of the concrete also have to compute for a given formula. And you may see it can be 20 to 40 gigapascal, depending on the strength of the concrete. Okay, and next, we talking about the ductility. What is the ductility? What the definition of the ductility? The ductility can be the ability of the material that can be deformed considerably before it fail, such as the mild steel has very large ductility. The material having large ductility can deform a lot when it fails. Okay, so the area under the stress strain diagram is going to be large. That means the material with high ductility can absorb large amount of energy because it can deform a lot, and the area under stress strain diagram also be large. We can use the percent of elongation to measure the Mandarin ductility. That's going to specify by Thailand Industrial Standard. And some other standard may use the percent area reduction to represent the ductility of the material, okay? And then there are other things such as elasticity, such as plasticity. I'd like you guys to study by yourself and understand about the definition of these words and what the mechanical property gonna represent this elasticity and plasticity. So that is an assignment you must work on your own. And then next, we're talking about five types of loading method on the specimen that we use in our material testing laboratory. We have tension test. Based on this, the free body diagram of the tension test is like this. And under the tension test, you may compute the normal stress due to the force that is going to be P equal to A. And you also must be able to determine the normal strain that is going to be delta over L. Okay, and then in the relationship of Hooke's law in the linear elastic, in the linear elastic region, sigma equal to E epsilon. So based on this, you can determine the deformation by using this equation. Okay, and this is going to be lab number three, also going to be in lab number two for the tension. That is the tension for the rubber band. This is the tension for the steel and the cast iron. And then we come to the compression test. This one, we test the steel, we test the cast iron because we use steel a lot in resisting the tension. In the compression, we can test the concrete most of the time in compression. And also we do the compression test for the timber that's parallel to grain. And also the brick, okay? That's quite a lot of compression tests. And by doing this again, can you compute for the stress? Can you compute the strain basis upon what we have in the lab? I'm not quite sure. The lab number five we are going to have in this week is going to be the compression of the timber, one parallel to grain, another one perpendicular to grain, and later you will have a chance to test for the brick. And for the dielectric, you have testing what Blaze from the last week, copper, okay, and also you have the test for the blaze, the copper, and aluminum, okay, that means you have the lot. And then you put the force to the lot, and then there is the resistance, and you'll be able to compute the tau equal to V over A. Since this one is double shear, so if the force is P, the tau is going to be P divided by 2A. And you also have a chance to test the shear for the timber. You have the specimen, have this kind of shape, and then you lock it, okay? And then you shear it by this one, and then there is the clap. This one is going to be in the form of single shear, and then the tau is going to be V over A, and it's going to be P over A. This is a kind of shear test that we have from the last week. We also have another shear test. This is going to be the torsion test. In the torsion, the specimen subjected to torsion, like your twist your finger like this, okay, and then the tau is going to be TR over J, and then you'll be able to determine the shear strain. That can be the angle phi time R divided by the length of the specimen, and then you can draw the shear stress, shear strain diagram, and then you'll be able to determine the shear modulus of elasticity. That is going to be the slope of this graph, and represent the stiffness of the material due to shear stress. And the last one, that's going to be lab for sure, number 8 and number 9. You must be able to determine the stresses occur in the beam. The equation is going to be sigma equal to my over I. And under this force, the beam will have the deflection. Okay, we will have a chance to check the deflection due to this force is going to be PL cubed over 48 EI. And then I suggest you guys at least to be able to use this kind of equation in our calculation in this subject, okay, maybe in this midterm examination. And for sure, in the so-called, in the final examination, that is going to have a lot of this kind of calculation. And then I may ask you about the name of this symbol, like the STM. Okay, please check. It's going to be American Society for Testing and Material. This is one of the most popular specification for the testing of the material in this world. Is very widespread using. And also in Thailand, we have this symbol. There are two types of this symbol. One just has the symbol with no circle. Another one have the circle. For the circle, that means this symbol, the manufacturer must follow the standard. It must be, if not, it's going to be illegal, okay? But for this one, if the product has this Thailand industrial standard symbol, that means this product is high quality, okay? Such as the P-class high, those kind of P-class slab, okay? If the manufacturer apply to the Thailand industrial standard, they will get this symbol, even though it's not legal. But if the product have this symbol, that means the product is high quality. Next, I also asking you to determine various mechanical property of the material, such as for this one, okay, I will erase all the number over here and ask you what is going to be the value of, like this one, okay, the value of what? Of proportional stress, the value of proportional strength, the value of yielding stress, the yielding strength. This kind of thing you have it in the laboratory already. So you must be able to determine this value. And some of them are really important, such as this one, and this one. They are specified in the Thailand industrial standard. So basis upon that, you must be able to determine the mechanical properties of the material from the stress strain diagram. And there are many types of stress strain diagram, such as I may ask you guys about this stress strain diagram. Can you determine those mechanical properties? Okay, or when we come to this one, for example, this is going to be the stress strain diagram for the polyethylene. Can you determine the modulus of elasticity of this one? Or you can determine what sigma sub y of this material. So the basic thing is following the learning objective of this course, in which you guys must be able to determine the mechanical property of the material. So I will give you the diagram like this, and you must take the value of this mechanical property and select the multiple choices properly. And then we come to the stress strain diagram. We classify the behavior of the material into four regions. Okay, as you may know, the first region over here is going to be very small region, as very close to the vertical normal stress axis. So we must have this what's so called phi scale stress strain diagram. Okay, and then the second part of this is going to be this part. This part called the yielding. I like you guys also know the definitions of this elastic. What is the elastic? Can you explain to me? Anyway, you got to select a proper choice for elastic. What is the yielding? What the meaning of yielding? What is the behavior of the materials during the yielding? What is going to be the behavior of the material during certain hardening? What the material behave in this portion? And the last point for this one is going to be related to the ultimate stress. And another thing, when we talking about the yielding stress, we take the yielding stress as the lower, okay, as the lower. But when we talking about the yielding strain, we take the strain from this value, see? So please, you must be able to first understand the definition of this part. And also, how about the necking? You see the necking of the steel during the tension test in the lab already. So you must explain each of this. You also must classify the behavior of the material properly. Okay? And then I may ask you about something. What is the error that can be both larger and smaller than the real value? We're talking about when we measure the diameter of the specimen. If I give five of you to measure a diameter of this pen in this region, okay, the value can be both larger and smaller. This kind of thing we call it the accidental error or the random error. This error must be analyzed to determine the mean, the standard deviation, and then we can use the reliability or probability to confirm our results. And there is another error, it's called systematic error. This kind of error are different. It's maybe on the larger side, or of the value will be larger, or it's maybe smaller, or of the value will be smaller. Talking about the speed of your motorcycle, okay, if your motorcycle speed is 100 kilometers per hour, and the speedometer from the police said, hey, that is only 95 kilometers per hour. So when you guys ride your bicycle to 110 kilometers per hour, so the speedometer will keep the value about this kilometer per hour. The systematic error, when this is small, so the next value will be get small. When you may collect the error, the systematic error by proportion, that is going to be easy to correct, okay? And then we talking about what is the characteristic of systematic error. That is what I'm saying. A car have the real speed of 200 kilometers per hour, and the speedometer said is 198 kilometers per hour. If the error is a systematic error, okay, and if the car have the real speed of 200 kilometers per hour, let's say this is incorrect, 220 kilometers per hour, what should be the number on the speedometer? That is going to be use this kind of proportion, and you get this value, okay? And systematic error, you may say that error take one size of the real value. This is going to be smaller size, okay? And then there is the other question that are important that I already discussed with you guys. Let's say about the equation that you guys must be able to basis on the lab that we just has it. You should be able to calculate the stress. You must be able to calculate the shear stress, the bending stress. Okay, no, this one not yet because you didn't do the fractional test yet, but this one and the shear and the torsion, you guys must be able to. And if I said the shaft SHAFT has this D equal to 125 millimeter, and what is going to be the J of this? You must be able to. What is going to be the A of this? And what is going to be the I of this shaft? Or if you have a rectangular column, and then this column subjected to the force P, this column has this one for 50 millimeter and this one for 100 millimeter, and then P is going to be 1 kilonewton. What is going to be the stress? And if this one is in linear elastic, can you compute the strain from the stress? So strain can be sigma divided by E, for example. And what is going to be the deformation of this column under 1 kilonewton? So basis on this, you will know the value of strain. And you know strain is deformation divided by L. So the deformation may be the strain time L, those kind of thing. And basis on this, what is going to be the moment of inertia of this section, okay? So that's going to be some calculation in our problem, but it's not much for this midterm examination. And this kind of calculation will be a lot in the final examination when we finish all the labs, and we The learning outcome requires your guide to be able to analyze this data and use it in the analysis and design of the structure. And next, the example for our question, what are the advantages and disadvantages when we talking about stain hardening? By talking about this, you guys must be able to understand what is the stain hardening when you have the stress strain diagram, for example, like this, and then you load this material passing through its elastic region and go to the plastic or inelastic region, and then you release the force. The return of the material won't follow the original curve, but it will go by this way in parallel with the first portion of the linear elastic, and then the graph, the stress strain diagram of this material will change. And what we have is, previously, this may be sigma sub y, but after you do the strain hardening, the value of the yielding point increase. Also, if you compare this elastic region with this elastic region, you can see the elastic region for this new behavior is going to be larger. But there is the drawback. Before you do the strain hardening, the material has very large deformation. The material have very large ductility. But after you do the strain hardening, the strain to the failure get smaller, so the ductility reduce. Also, if you consider the new area under the curve of this one, going to be smaller than the original one. That means they still have lower modulus of toughness. Okay, that's going to be the multiple choice question. You guys supposed to read the choices carefully and slowly in a limited time. And then the question may ask you, what do we call the material that has very low ultimate tensile stress compared to its ultimate compressive stress? This kind of material, you know, when we test in tension, the stress strain diagram is going to be very small. However, when you test it in compression, the stress strain diagram is big. This kind of material usually is going to be the brittle material, and we have concrete, masonry, rock, or cast iron for this one. Why? Why is happen like this? Because the material such as the concrete is has micro crack inside it. Where is micro crack come from? When you cast the concrete, the cement paste and the aggregate will connect to each other, but usually it's not perfectly bonded together. So there are some micro crack. So when you test the concrete in tension, the micro crack will open rapidly, and then it fell in the brittle manner. Okay, but when we compress the concrete, all those micro crack just close up. Okay, and then there also the Poisson effect. So the concrete can take large forces, large compression before the failure, and it also occur in the cast iron or the lock. Okay, and I may give you like the what the stress strain diagram like this one, and may ask you guys a simple question. For example, this one has no clear yielding point, unlike the previous one, this one has a clear yielding point. Again, I may ask you guys, what is the method that we use to determine the yielding stress of this mostly alloy? So you may answer 0.2% offset. Okay, and then you may be able to determine the yielding stress for this kind of material. So both of these two graphs were used in the past. Okay, anyway, based on learning objective, you guys supposed to be able to find the yielding stress. And then we talking about the Poisson ratio. The value of Poisson ratio can be in the range of 0 to 0.5. And when we test the rubber, we know the value of the Poisson ratio will be about 0.4. And then it said, which material has the Poisson ratio closest to the value of 0? So it's not the rubber. The rubber must have the value that's closest to 0.5. But what the material that has Poisson ratio close to 0? So you may answer the lock or the concrete. This value gonna close. Can the Poisson ratio be 0? The Poisson ratio is minus strain lateral divided by strain lateral. If this one is 0, it means this one is 0. This is not possible. It's impossible, because when you pull the material elongate. Why the elongate? The lateral direction or dimension of the material must be contract. That's to take the volume before the force equal to the volume of the material after the force applied to it. So it's not possible to get the Poisson ratio of 0. Okay, and then the last one, I may ask you from the last portion of chapter 4, the definition of some important words such as creep. Creep is the material failure due to permanent deformation that is continuously increased in some materials such as concrete until the structure cannot perform its intended function as designed. Why this happened? Because in the concrete, there is the void inside it, and then also water in the void. When you compress the concrete, water will leak out, and then when the water leak out, the material has permanent deformation, and this permanent deformation will return when the water coming back. Okay, and it's important in the design of pre-stasis concrete structure. Okay, that's going to reduce the efficiency of the pre-stasis force. Next, you also be able to give the definition of fatigue. Fatigue occur when structural member or mechanical part that made by the ductile material, and then such as the steel, and when that structure subjected to repeated load under the action of the repeated load or stress, and the stress is less than yielding stress or sigma sub u, that's ductile material fail in the brittle manner, because when the steel or ductile materials manufacturers it has some micro crack inside it, and under the action of the repeated forces or repeated stresses, that micro crack get larger and larger, and until to reach to some point, there is no enough material to resist the stresses or forces. So the failure change for ductile failure to the brittle failure. And the last one, we may talking about the buckling. Buckling is the instability or elastic failure of the column under compression. And then we also have what so-called the relaxation. This occur very close to creep, but creep occur in the concrete. Relaxation is the material failure due to permanent deformation that's constantly increased in the material such as steel, okay? Under the tension due to the movement into the sliding of the steel grain. So when it occur in the steel, the stress in the steel will reduce, and the prestresses effect in the prestresses concrete structure also decrease, okay? And this supposed to be some example for the question that I may ask you guys to select a proper choices in our examination. That's going to take about 90 minutes. And then the second portion, I will give you the stress strain diagram and ask you, for example, to determine the deformation for the stress strain diagram of polyester, which is used to cheat coaxial cable, okay? Is determined from testing the specimen having the gate length of 250 millimeter, and then if the load, we develop a strain of 0.0024. That is going to be here. The strain is going to be here. Okay. Determine the appropriate length of the specimen. So this is in the plastic region. That means this is going to be strain at the plastic. So you cannot use the Hooke's law to determine the strain. Hooke's law can use only in the linear elastic. So when you get this from this one, you just project this one up, okay? And then you may get the stress for this one to be about this. They said, determine the appropriate length of the specimen measure between the gauge point. Okay, the first one, you got to determine the strain first. So based on this, from the stress strain diagram, when the strain is 0.002, you project it up, and then you may determine this one, and then you project it in which this line must be perpendicular to the vertical line. And you may get this one to be the stress. That is going to be the plastic stress. And then that can be 26 or 25.9 megapascal or Newton per square meter. So that is very easy, right? And then when you like to determine this, what is going to be the elongation of this? So strain equal to delta over L. So by doing this, delta can be strain time L. You may determine the deformation of this specimen to be 0.024 and then time 250 millimeter, you will get the deformation of this to be the value of it. Now, if you put this one into your calculator, you may get the deformation to be, let's say, it's going to be 0.024 times 250. That is 6 millimeter. That is going to be 6 millimeter. And then based on this, you may release the force. Okay, when you release the force, the return of this portion will follow this portion. That means you must determine the modulus of elasticity in this portion. Okay, based upon this, they mark about this point, 0.004, and then you may use your ruler perpendicular to this and draw the line up over here, and then you may get this one, and let's say you estimate this one to be 14 megapascal. So this is going to be 14 divided by 0.004. So this one can be 3.5 gigapascal. And by doing this, you may calculate for this one. This is going to be recovery strength. And then what we determine is going to be, this is going to be sigma equal to E epsilon. And we determine strain recovery. So that is going to be stress divided by E. And stress over here, as we know, is going to be plastic stress. So based on this one, this is going to be the plastic stress divided by E, 25.9 divided by E. You get this one for the elastic recovery. Then this is going to be the strain permanent. The strain permanent, we call it permanent set, is going to be the plastic strain of 0.024. minus recovery strain, that is going to be this strain value. And again, if you determine it based on the deformation equal to strain time L, that means under the plastic strain, the deformation is 6 millimeter. Now, when you release the force, the permanent strain change to 4.15. So the elastic recovery, so the elastic recovery deformation is going to be 6 minus 4.15. That is going to be 1.85 millimeter. Then the specimen after you release all the force will be 254.15 millimeter. This kind of calculation, okay, may you must be understand it. You must be able to do it to understand the elastic behavior, plastic behavior, the elastic recovery, the permanent set, and then finally, you may be able to determine the deformation, the what's so called this elastic deformation, this elastic recovery deformation. This is the permanent set deformation. That is another example. And that's all I can provide you with some example. And I like to ask you guys to go back to the example like this one and try to work on this kind of problem practices. You will get used to with it and you can solve this kind of problem. We will have chapter 5 and chapter 6 for the major part of the final examination. But don't forget about chapter 1 to chapter 4. There are some of them will be in the final examination also. And then on the chapter 5, there are some important characteristics of our thesis in this material testing course. And we start by review the thesis that we have. And we have 1, 2, 3, 4, and 5 types. And the first, the free body diagram of this thesis. Can you dock it? And then can you determine the stresses and strain in this kind of thesis? Also, I mean the deformation. And again, from this thesis, there are two types of material, such as the ductile material. When we talking about the ductile material, what going to be the result from each thesis? And we also has the brittle materials, okay? The result from the test also be different. From what we understand, you supposed to be able to apply the characteristics of the test in the civil engineering material testing properly. Okay, let me start by the static tension test and later by the static compression test. What are going to be important characteristics of them? On the static tension test, we test the steel, we test the cast iron to determine the mechanical property. The mechanical property that are important to us based on the Thailand industrial standard, that's going to be yielding stress, ultimate stress, percent of elongation, and modulus of elasticity. We also have some kind of aluminum alloy, and can you determine this mechanical property? Like I show you guys from the review of chapter 1 to chapter 4. In Thailand, the steel manufacturer must follow the Thai industrial standard for structural steel section. There are two things. One, they must follow the chemical composition that make the structural steel. That's why you guys must study the engineering materials in order to understand the effect of carbon, of silica, of manganese, of the copper, okay, in the steel. And next, in this subject, we focus on the mechanical property, okay, the yielding, the ultimate stress, the percent elongation, and then the testing procedure. When you take the specimen, you must follow the procedure specified in the TAS. And then what should we consider when we do the tension test and the compression test? As you know, the structural member, such as the steel in this truss, the bottom of this steel truss subjected to tension. However, this portion of the steel subjected to compression, why don't we do the compression test for the steel? Okay, or when we come to the reinforced concrete column, you can see the steel over here is in compression, and the concrete also in compression. The problem is for the steel, the stress strain diagram of the steel, the behavior of the steel, and even the mode of failure of the steel, intention and incompetence, they are the same. But testing the steel intention is easy. We, as you may see, we just put the specimen into the UTM, and then we can tie the specimen, or the UTM have the grip that can catch the specimen easily. So for the steel, the tension test is going to be more popular than the compression test. Okay, first, we use steel a lot in tension. Second, since the behavior, intention and compression are the same, and the tension test of the steel is easier to perform. So we test the steel in tension. But for concrete or for brick, we use them in compression. So most of the time, we test the concrete and the brick by the compression test. So the first reason for this is based on the application of the material in the behavior. And the second, the third is talking about the installation of the testing specimen. As I mentioned, the steel is going to be easier to test in compression, okay? And what we test for the tension in the concrete is going to be by splitting tensile test, because we cannot pull the concrete the same way as we pull the steel, okay? That's going to be the reason. And one more thing is about the differences in the mechanical property of the material. This occurs in the timber. The timber has the behavior based on the direction of the grain, okay? Most of the time when we use it, the force occur in the timber can be compression. And for this one, it will produce the shear. And the problem is, even though the timber has high tensile strength compared to the compressive strength and compared to the shear strength, but we usually use this timber for this one, for the compression, and another one for the shear. That's why we test the timber in compression. That is going to be lab number 5 for this week. And last week, we do test the timber in the shear test, okay? And that's the reason why we select the way we test the material. And talking about the specimen intention can be circular or also can be square or rectangular. But for a typical specimen, we have this kind of section reduction. Why? Why we use the portion over here larger than at the middle? Because we like to control the failure in the middle portion. And then we also have this one to has a uniform distribution of the forces in the specimen under the test, okay? And there is various type of end of the specimen. In our lab number 3, we use this kind of thread end. There are some improper specimen we should not use, or we should reject them from the test. It can be this one, the center line are not in the same center line, or this one has the unsymmetric size, and this one has the what the center line of reduced section and the end do not coincide, or this one have the imperfect section. Okay, and then if we talking about the STM-E8, that's what we have. There are some other thing we guys must be understand about this kind of test, but usually this detail is too much for examination. So I will leave this one for you guys to use it when you guys do the testing of the steel and the cast iron, especially based on the STM-E8. And for the concrete, again, we cannot take the concrete specimen in tension like we did in lab number 3. We got to use the same cylinder specimen, but we put the force into the specimen in this way. Is called the split tensile test. And with the split tensile test, the mechanical inside the concrete will be like this. The force that we apply will transmit in the concrete, okay? And then the force that's transmit in the concrete will produce the force like this. And then that force by the third law of Newton will produce this kind of tensile force inside the concrete and cause the concrete to fail in tension. And you can calculate the compressive strength of the concrete by using this equation. Okay, the detail is over here. And then when we let me pass this one. Okay, it has a crack over here. When we talking about the machine, there are 3 of them in the tension test. This one for the rubber band test, and this one we have kit for lab number 3, and for the split concrete test, we will put the concrete cylinder over here and we'll compress it by this 200 kilonewton compression testing machine. So different lab use different testing machine. And then when you do the test, you must take a lot of observation for the specimen, for the testing machine, for the speed of testing machine, and also about the load controlling test and the displacement controlling test. And also the mode of failure that can be ductile or can be brittle material. As I mentioned before, for the load controlling test, the load going to be the main thing. And the guys who control the load will ask the friend to list the dial gauge for the deformation. This kind of load controlling test, as shown over here, is going to be good for the linear elastic portion. But for the non-linear elastic portion, especially at the yielding, you may increase the load, but the load won't increase, only the deformation increase. So the problem occur, and the load controlling test only good for the linear elastic portion, and also is good for brittle materials, okay? But for this displacement load, displacement controlling test, we use the displacement to control the test. And each displacement, you may ask your friend to read the load. By doing so, it can be used in both linear region and in the non-linear region properly. And most of the UTM nowadays, they use the displacement controlling test in the lab. And then when the machine fail, the specimen fail, you must take note on it. You must draw the picture in the lab in order you guys to get used to with the failure of this one for the cast iron. And this one is will similar to the steel. And if there is some imperfect like this, it's maybe due to the eccentricity when you do the test. So taking a lot of observation for the failure of the material, include the appearance, include the cracking pattern, and also the profile and the cause of the surface of the failure plane. And then when you do the test, I ask you guys to check the specimen, would it be coincide with the applied force? Why? When the specimen is in, for example, let's say tension, it's going to be better in tension, okay? And then even the tension or compression, if the force coincide with the centroid of the specimen, the stress does occur on the section will be uniformly distributed load. And being uniformly distributed load, that means the result that we get gonna represent the strength of the material properly. But if the load has some eccentricity, this load will produce the extra moment. So based upon this, the specimen will subject to both. One is due to the force P, that sigma equal to P over A. And another one may be due to the moment. And then based upon this, this one may be in the compression and this one may be in the tension. When you combine them together, one size of the specimen will subjected to sigma equal to my over I, large compression, and the other side may be small compression. And by unequal stress distribution, the material over here will fail first. And then the result that we obtain will be lower than what's supposed to be. Okay, so the material will fail earlier with the lower failure load than its actual load resistant capacity of the material. So this is important, the eccentricity. The speed of the test, okay, also important, but we do the static, very slow testing. So the effect of the speed is not important in our laboratory, but it's maybe important in some other tests, okay? And the failure of the steel and the cast iron, you have it in the lab. Number three, this one for sure is in the steel, and this one for sure is going to be in the cast iron. And you may see for the steel, in the tension test, the stress supposed to be the one that's caused the failure of the steel. No, the steel have the necking. The necking is what is occur due to the slipping of the plane of the steel grain. So the steel, even though it's subjected to the normal stress, but it's failed by shear stress. And the angle over here is going to be 45 degree with the longitudinal axis. When we consider the cast iron, they are different. Cast iron has some carbon inside it. Okay, when you pull it, the material, the micro crack in the material open, and then the stress cause the separation of the plane of the steel grain. The normal stress will be the one that caused the failure of this cast iron, and the crack is going to be 90 degrees with the or with the longitudinal axis, this is going to be 45 degrees. So different material have different failure mode, and the steel has the ductile failure mode, and the cast iron has the abrupt or brittle failure mode. Okay, and then if you go consider the structure in tension, then we move to the structure that's in compression. This is what? This is the column, okay? And this portion of the truss is made by steel, is also in compression. The column for sure is in compression, and the steel for this tower also in compression. The reinforced concrete over here also in compression. So there are a lot of structural and structural members are in compression. The compression test also important. In the compression test, most of the time we do for the concrete, for example, or cast iron. And you can see for the cast iron, the stress strain diagram for the tension going to be very small due to the micro crack opening. But when you compress it, the micro crack just close to each other, and also there is the Poisson effect. So the stress strain diagram of the cast iron in compression going to be huge compared to the one in tension. And we measure three things: yielding compressive stress, ultimate compressive stress, and modulus of elasticity. And then you should notice one important thing. Even though the behavior under tension different from in compression, but the modulus of elasticity of the cast iron in tension equal to one in compression. Okay, and then eccentricity also important. Again, the same reason: when the eccentricity occur, there is a moment and produce non-uniform stresses, and the point subjected to high stress will fail first, and it's going to cause the early failure, and then we will get the lower failure load compared to the actual load carrying capacity of the material. Okay, and there is something else about this buckling. Buckling also important. If the steel is long enough and you put the compression into the steel, you may notice from overlap the steel get the buckling, and this is not the material failure. The buckling is going to be stability failure. Okay, and for testing the material such as the concrete, the specimen will have some specific shape. For example, for the concrete, the cylinder may have 150 millimeter diameter and have the length of 300 millimeter. This way we will prevent the buckling. But since the specimen has large section and short, so the testing machine needs to be high capacity and is supposed to have high accuracy for measuring devices. And then the third thing, when we push the specimen in compression, what happened is the size of the specimen will buck out due to the Poisson effect. But at this point, the surface of the steel and the surface of the concrete specimen will develop friction. If the friction is large enough, it may cause the early failure occur in this region, and you will get the lower actual load carrying capacity of the material. You may prevent this one by putting the plaster or the sulfur at the capping top and bottom of the surface of the concrete specimen. Okay, and there are some important dimension due to the buckling under the compression test. The length of the specimen must be carefully selected to prevent the buckling. Okay, the length of the specimen is not larger than 8 to 10 times of the specimen diameter, and also you must be prevent from the friction as the surface of the specimen and the testing machine. So the specimen should not shorter than 2D. That means it's the proper one. For the steel, you may select D and 3D in according to the STM E9. Okay, and then why some cylinder has this kind of dimension D and 2D? When we talking about the concrete cylinder, the aggregate that's used in a typical concrete is in between of 25 to 51 millimeter, and then the diameter of the cylinder should not be larger than 3 times the largest aggregate. That means D is going to be 150 millimeter. If it's larger than 3 times of the aggregate, the side effect will occur in the specimen. It will produce no good result because you put too big crushed stone in your concrete. Okay, and then due to the friction over here, the length is going to be 300 millimeter. Okay, and that's why we have 150 millimeter diameter and 300 millimeter high concrete cylinder following the ASTM standard and the TS adopted. There is also type of the specimen. If you use smaller, you may use like a smaller specimen like this one. If you use this, it's maybe 75 millimeter, and this one can be 150 millimeter. Okay, if you use a smaller size of aggregate. Okay, and then there is some important tests that is going to be this week for lab number 5. We will test the timber or wood in compression, and later we will put to mix to test in compression, and then the concrete in compression in the later weeks after our midterm examination. And the last one I have discussed before about the stress strain diagram of the brittle material. They say if we're talking about a cast iron, okay, for the tension and compression, they are going to be the same for the linear elastic region. However, for cast iron can fail abruptly in the tension because the opening or the fast going of micro crack causes by the tension. But when we put the cast iron under compression, okay, it has ductile material because what? Because the micro crack cross to each other, and also it has the lateral expansion due to the Poisson effect. So the cast iron, also the concrete, can resist very large compression compared to the tension. And the failure, okay, the failure of the of the metal like gay cast iron will very close to the theory, the crack occur about 45 degree. Was due to the roughness of the surface of the concrete, the crack of the concrete get higher to 50 to 90 degree with the vertical line. Okay, that's due to what's sorry for this one, I didn't check it, the concrete. Okay, and then for the failure mode later in the lab, when we do the compression test of the concrete, you may notice the crack of the concrete can typically be two ways for the cylinder. And also we will have another kind of concrete specimen, like I draw it over here, is in the form of cubic. Why do we have the cubic specimen? This one usually used in the pavement, okay, of the road. Typically the pavement is going to be a kind of slab that we put it on the ground, and then the wheel of the vehicle will put the load onto this slab. And then if you cut the specimen on the slab, it will have the shape like a cubic. That's why we test the cubic in the pavement construction. And then how about the cylinder? We're talking about the structure such as column. Okay, that is in the form of cylinder. So there are two big types of the concrete specimen, different on what we use in the construction. Anyway, you got to check out the cylinder is going to fail by which one in our laboratory. Okay, and for the failure of the concrete, the angle is not follow the theoretical value, it has higher crack compared to the vertical axis like this. Is due to the non-homogeneous of the material, because it has the crust rock, it has the surface, so the crack surface going to be rough, and then the angle just get bigger. Also the rough surface cause the friction, not only the crack, okay, it's also the friction at the loading head at the specimen that's going to produce the crack of 50 to 60 degree also. Okay, for the timber has the grain, okay, that is the grain of the timber. So when you put the timber in or wood in compression, there are various type of failure based on the direction of the grain that's naturally occur. So next lab number 5, you guys must be carefully observe how or the way the timber fail. Okay, that timber also tested in two ways, one perpendicular to grain. Okay, this one will be failed by crushing of the timber, and the behavior of this one is the ductile like. Okay, and you also, this one, what it mean, you have the specimen like this, and then you has the grain in this direction. Okay, and then you apply the force in this direction, is mean perpendicular. But for the typical use of the timber, we use the timber as the column, and then the grain of the timber will be in the longitudinal direction of the column. And then when you apply the force like this for the column, the force going to be in the direction of the grain. The failure of this one is due to the buckling of the grain, and it will be brittle, what's so called whistle like or rupture of the timber. So there are a lot of things about the timber, and that's all for today.